it's easy to understand. Keep in mind, Selma, Dallas County, South Alabama, even then, had a large African-American population. I can't remember the figures. But all over South Alabama, there were black majority counties everywhere. And the white folks in those who were the minority, they were terrified. They were afraid that the black majority was finally going to get enough and rise up against them. And never mind that the black majority was there because, you know, they didn't choose to be there. Just about 100% of those black folks were descendants of people who, well, there might have been a few who descendants of some guy who jumped on the boat in Africa at the last minute and said, "Wait for me." it was not their business being there. They hadn't, and suddenly they're in a majority. And the white people, understandably, were afraid that the black folks were going to take over. Well, guess what has happened? The black folks have taken over in South Alabama and right across Mississippi and Louisiana. And things have turned out okay. I was in Selma about 2 weeks ago with our grandson, Vincent. Some of you know Vincent. He went to the university. He was in one of Hoy's classes, one of Gerald's classes. And he wanted to go see Selma. So he and I drove down there. And I was astonished at what has happened in Selma, Alabama. First of all, it's a very tidy little place. Still about 20,000 people. It's a sleepy little southern town, clean. And I learned the figures while I was there, and I forget now, but not only Dallas County, Selma, but all of those South Alabama counties are now governed by African Americans. They hold every job of any consequence, county government, city government. And guess what? The world has not come to an end. Folks get along. After all that tumult and violence and bloodshed, it has worked out pretty well.
How long had you been on that beat when someone at the bridge happened?
Just a couple of months.
Wow.
Yeah, I went to work January 1st, 65 in New York. I was supposed to stay 2 months, and things were heating up so fast and so they cut it short. And Norma and I had not really got moved in the Atlanta Bureau. You know, we were just sort of feeling our way. But I had to leave immediately. I couldn't even stay and help them pack, as Norma recalls it. I was spending all my time in Selma. But for about 30 days, the stories were fairly routine. You know, there was a march, and people would go down to the courthouse and attempt to register to vote. They'd be turned away. But no real violence. Indignity, as this film shows in another part, the indignity of trying to satisfy a test to be able to register to vote. A ridiculous test.
Like a literacy?
Literacy test. Can you recite the preamble of the Constitution? Some of you have seen the movie. You remember the scene.
Yeah.
And that wasn't good enough when Mrs. Cooper. And then the guy says, "All right, recite the whole Constitution." Well, not even Fort Gilman can do it. it was just fairly quiet until the murder of Jimmie Lee Jackson. And incidentally, the movie got it wrong, and so have any number of other places. He was not killed in Selma, Alabama. He was killed up the road 30 miles in a town called Marion, which until then was known. If anything, for anything, it was known as the birthplace in the hometown of Coretta Scott King, Martin Luther King's wife. And overnight, it became known as the hometown of Jimmie Lee Jackson, a state trooper. Shot him to death one night at a cafe at the end of a administration. Shot him to death for no good reason. He was there with his grandfather and his mother, and the police came storming in to this cafe where they'd taken refuge, beating up people right and left. And Jimmy Lee, who was only 26 years old, went to protect his mother. He didn't try to interfere with the officer. He didn't try to take his gun up like that, just hovering over his mother. And the trooper shot him to death. And this led directly to the March on Montgomery that eventually changed America. And it most immediately, it was what prompted the march to Montgomery that we saw the scene of in there on Bloody Sunday. That was the first attempted march. There was a second where they turned around and went back, and then the third under federal protection, which went all the way to Montgomery. I have a few problems with the movie that are no fault of the movie makers. They were not allowed to use the words of Martin Luther King, copyright protection. Yeah. His family, King's family, owns his words. Yeah. And to get permission to use his words, you have to go through a whole rigmarole and pay some money. And I think it's unforgivable, but they forgot to ask me before they... I will read you Martin Luther King's actual words. He preached Jimmie Lee Jackson's funeral just a few days before the march began. The people who made the movie, what was her name, the director? But anyway, she did a really good job trying to get the tone of his words without using his actual words. She did a good job. But they were not his words, and nobody could speak or use the English language the way Martin. I want to read you a few paragraphs of what he actually said. I was there. We didn't have tape recorders in those days, or at least not tape recorders that could be carried around portable. So 6 or 8 of us reporters got our heads together immediately after this eulogy by Dr. King and compared notes, but we knew that we had been hearing history in the making there, and we wanted to try to get it as close as we could to his actual words. And this is the way we recorded what he had to say, talking about Jimmy Lee. He was murdered by the indifference of every white minister of the gospel who has remained silent behind the safe security of his stained glass windows. He was murdered by the irresponsibility of every politician from governor's on down who has fed his constituents the stale bread of hatred and the spoiled meat of racism. He was murdered by the timidity of the federal government that is willing to spend millions of dollars a day to defend freedom in Vietnam, but cannot protect the rights of its citizens at home. He was murdered by the brutality of every sheriff who practices lawlessness in the name of the law. And he was murdered by the cowardice of every Negro who passively accepts the evils of segregation and stands on the sidelines in the struggle for justice. That might have been the best speech I ever heard him make. I can still hear his voice, and I'm sure there are people in this room who can hear that very unique. Kyle, didn't you catch that? You don't say very unique. Did not do that.
Yes, you did.
Anyway, it was a speech for the ages. I'm glad I was there.
You were about 34 years old at this time, an outsider. I'm sure that people in Selma and the other towns in Alabama knew you didn't live there. What was your relationship with the locals, and did you, in those 2 months before the Pettus Bridge incident, had you established relationships with any of the leaders in the civil rights movement?
The civil rights people, oh sure, they were very open and helpful. Jim Bevel, the guy with the skull cap, Hosea Williams, the other, John Lewis, the two guys who got beaten at the bridge, Lewis, what a hero. Y'all heard him speak, by the way. He has a little speech impediment. And he had it then, and he still has it today. And I kind of love him for it. Here's a guy who, by any standards of the public figure, ought to have been held back, but nothing was going to hold John Lewis back, including having his skull cracked that day in Selma at Billy Club, cracked his skull. He had to go to the emergency room and then went back to Brown's Chapel to help calm people down and then plan that march going on later on. So establishing relationships with people like that was no problem. They understood that we were there to tell their story. The white people were different matter. Can you imagine me establishing a working relationship with Sheriff Jim Clark? He was the guy on the horse with a horse whip, meeting his, or with Major Cloud to say, I counted the other day in some other connection. In fact, I was trying to remember this was the benefit of the grandson Vincent when we got to Selma. I remember that I could count exactly 4 white people in Selma who were friendly to the outside press. A couple who had come down from the north to run a factory, and they made it their business to befriend me and the other outside members of the press. They'd have us some dinner and drinks, that kind of thing. The editor of the local paper, who was a really good guy, and the Episcopal priest. Yeah. I'm still partial to the Episcopal paper. Aside from that, no, nobody I could count on. If I'd been in trouble, if I'd been chased down by a mob, and that happened to more than one white person in some,
right?
I would have sought safety in the black community. This black couple, this white couple I mentioned, they lived up on a hill way out of town. I couldn't have made it there. But no, that's the situation. So it was a case of flying by the seat of your pants.
Were people there aware of what you were writing? not necessarily just that you were writing, but would they see the New York Times stories?
Yes. Not many. I doubt if there was a single subscriber. But they had outliers who would keep them informed. This is what that damn newspaper said today. This phone, somebody himself, it would be passed around. And so there were no friendly faces. They all knew. And if they didn't know exactly what I'd been, they knew instinctively that they were not going to like it. And I was not the only one. I was the only reporter represented in this movie. But there were several dozen of us there at one point. And they couldn't afford to have one. The Los Angeles Times had a guy there, Jack Nelson. He was in town one time. Anybody remember who Jack was? And a bunch of others. And we in the press tended to huddle together, not just for safety, but for kind of comfort. One of the things that I admit all these years later in my memoir that I was reading from is a place where all of us reporters gathered for dinner every night after we'd filed our stories. This is a shameful confession, but it's time to come clean. Tally Ho was the name of this club. It was on the edge of town. And it was a private club, which meant that they did not have to admit black folks, or God knows any other folks they didn't like. It was a private club. There are a lot of people here old enough to remember, but we had several laws in Arkansas. You couldn't serve a drink openly in the town of Fayetteville, for example, unless you were a private club. The country club, you could get a drink there. And there were 2 or 3 other private clubs, and that was the system. We all understood that. Well, the Tally Ho Club is the only place in Fayetteville, only place in Selma, where you could get a drink at the end of the day. So that's where we went. And we paid our $5 a year membership or something like that. And we became members of this whites-only Tally Ho Club. I'm embarrassed about it, but there you have it. I did it. When I had Vincent down there, I took him to visit the Tally Ho Club, took some pictures.
It's still there?
It's still there. They cleaned up their act. It's now open to the public. They have black members. Yeah. I was ahead of my time. But I think I remember this correctly. I think the first time I ever drank a martini was in the Tally Ho Club. I'm a faithful adherent to this day.
There should be something on the menu, the Roy Reed. They should come up with a drink of martini. The scene depicted in the film that we watched shows you somewhere on the periphery. Do you remember where you were standing in relation?
Exactly, yeah. On the shoulder of the highway, on the Montgomery side of the Pettus Bridge, waiting for them to come down. And the authorities have kind of cordoned us off, not by force, but just, you fellas stand over here. And that was customary. They weren't picking on us. That was an old savage rule. We have a large number of press people. We were on the shoulder, about maybe 30 yards from the front ranks of the state troopers. And we were there when they moved forward, and they were there. We were there when they threw the tear gas bombs, and we got tear gassed along with the marchers. Not nearly as much as they did, but enough. It takes a very little tear gas to go a long way. Have any of you ever breathed tear gas? I'd like to hear your story.
It was actually in D.C. when Martin Luther King got killed.
When he got killed? Yes. Oh my God, yes, of course. Yeah. But do you remember the sensation of trying to breathe?
Yeah, I mean, it was intense. But...
Oh yeah. Your eyes, you can't see, you can't breathe. And if you can't breathe, you feel like you're going to die, but you can't breathe. So anyway, we've got enough, but the marchers got full run. I mean, it was awful to watch.
So at this time, because you, as you mentioned, you don't have a tape recorder, you don't have a movie camera, so you're taking notes.
Yeah.
This may be a silly question, but how are you taking notes and watching at the same time? That seems like, because you're seeing history unravel quickly in front of you.
I never did get any good at it. You're so tense that you can't, what happened, you can't read your own notes. But you get a word here and there. Luckily, the story did not depend on direct quotes. The story told itself. I had to do very little work as recollecting. It literally told itself. It was so brutal. Easy. But I was taking notes. And I guess I ought to see if I can find that notebook sometime.
You had to dictate the story, correct?
Yeah.
You didn't file it. I mean, you had to go to... It shows you at a phone booth in the movie. Did you do it from a phone booth, or did you go back? Because I know you did some at the Howard Hotel.
Yeah, this is one of the minor flaws in the movie. They couldn't get everything. You know, and for dramatic purposes, they had me dictating from a phone booth there at the scene. Well, I didn't do that. First of all, I followed the marcher back across the bridge to the church, and then did some follow-up interviews, and then made my way back to the Albert Hotel, where all of us recorded the stay, and had plenty of time before my deadline to write the story and call it into New York in the comfort of my hotel, in the full knowledge that somebody was over here, you know, listening to my call, because, well, that's just what you had to expect.
You mean tapped?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. I want to know what you're... That's one way they knew what I was writing every day. And I don't blame them. You know, they needed to keep abreast of events, just like everybody else. We assumed they were passing it on to the informants, you know, the police, that kind of thing. Incidentally, the police themselves were friendly. And this movie, I think I remember this right, along with just about every other source I've consulted, got it wrong about the Selma police.
Now you're talking the city police.
City police, yeah. The villains, day after day, were the county police, the sheriff and his deputies. And on Bloody Sunday, the state police, but they weren't there day after day. You know, they were just there that one day. Sheriff Jim Clark and his deputies, they were the bad guys in this story. The commissioner of public safety, his name was, Baker, his name was a good guy. And he went out of his way to protect the black marchers and do what he could to befriend them. I saw him one night after all this. There was some of the kids decided they wanted to have a night march. And he stopped them before they got into the downtown Selma and talked them out of it. He said, you know what's going to happen. You're going to get down there, and those sheriff's deputies are going to come and get you, and they're going to beat you black and blue. At the very least, you're going to be hurt, and some of you may be killed. And he talked them out of it and sent them back home. And he was that kind of a guy. He would try to intervene, but he and the sheriff were enemies. It did no good. And it did me a lot of satisfaction later on to learn that he and the sheriff had run against each other for the job of sheriff. And he had defeated the sheriff in 3-9 office. That's a sideline. Yeah, what were you asking?
Wondering about the dictation. You did that at the Albert Hotel. Would you type it up, write it out? I mean,
type it up if I had time, or just. Usually there was not time. We had a very early first edition. It was, I think, 6:30 Eastern time, 5:30 Central time. So you didn't have time to do a lot of polishing and rewriting like we like to do.
Right.
You have to do a lot of senior pass, occasionally dictating from your notes from a phone booth. But on this particular occasion, I had time to at least write a lead. And I would call to a number at the Times in New York where they had, at that time, 3, maybe 4 men on duty taking calls from all over the world. Times had bureaus all over the world and all over this country. And they would find out who was calling and attach me to a recording machine up there. And then every 2 or 3, 4 minutes, they would interrupt, and just to be sure that they were hearing everything right, and they'd ask me to spell a certain name. And picture this, these guys were all native New York City. I'm a native of Arkansas. I was easy compared to some of those dudes from the South. There's a line in My Fair Lady, hearing. Yorkshireman converse or worse here Cornishman.
Right.
Well, and they got the new accents like that. So I was, but even I gave them trouble, and they'd have to interrupt now and then and say, what was that word there? That was the scheme, and they would type it in takes, that is, short pieces of paper, 3 or 4 paragraphs of motion, and ship it out to the newsroom, and it would immediately go into the editing process. That's the way it was done before we had what do they use nowadays?
Your phone?
Tablets?
Yeah, tablets.
Magic now.
There would be times, I mean, you could do this story from the Albert Hotel, but there would be times you'd be on the road or away from a hotel, I would imagine, that you'd have to find a phone and maybe not know where you were going to find it to report.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, it happened quite often. I remember an evening in Selma, a Saturday afternoon, at most big daily papers, there's an early first edition, because the Sunday paper has to go to bed. When would it be, Tom? How early would we have to? Typically, you'd have to get your stories in two or three hours before the usual deadline, because the Sunday papers, you know, everything's going to be in early. And on this Saturday afternoon in Selma, a bunch of kids, including little kids, marched down to the courthouse because they decided that if the grown-ups could do it, they could do it. And they marched right up to the courthouse steps, and there was Sheriff Clark. I guess he had been alerted that these kids were coming. And he said, you kids want to march? And they said, you know, yes, we do. And he said, all right, well, I'm going to let you march. Y'all follow me. And he put a, I guess he was in the lead car, and he put a deputy behind him. There were maybe three or four dozen of these kids, ranging from, I think, grade school age up to high school. And he marched them out of town, out past the city limits, at a pretty brisk pace. When they got out on the open road, he stepped it up just a little bit, so they had to run to keep up. And after no more than a mile, maybe less, they simply couldn't go anymore. The kids started falling out in people's yards and vomiting and crying. And so the sheriff then, you know, turned around and went back. And the last thing I saw when they pulled out was that he and his deputy were laughing. Now that's the kind of people we're dealing with. It was just about more than a normal human being could stand. But you got to think, you got to remember, they were doing what they saw as the Lord's work. I mean, they were protecting their way of life, and it took brutality, but that's the way it had to be. I do believe they were not. I mean, they were mean. I mean, Clark, we had a mean streak. He liked doing this. But the average white resistor, normal human being, you know, maybe a deacon of the church, at the Boy Scouts, you know, a decent, ordinary human being, they truly believed that they had to do this to keep the black majority from taking over, because that would upend the whole society. And it was not just a matter of power, it was that certainly. But it was the way God intended for things.
You've used the word villains when we've been talking. When you're learning journalism, when you're thinking objectivity, but you want to tell the truth, did you ever have to check yourself? Did you ever think about what you were reporting? Because you obviously couldn't use the word villain then.
Oh, yeah. No, I have the great luxury of being superintended by what might have been the best copy editor in the world at that time. And even if I'd attempted to slip in a word here or there, they wouldn't let me get away with it.
Was that ever difficult, though, for you personally? I mean,
oh, sure. But, you know, I'd been trained. By the way, Heather, you left out the Joplin Globe. I spent a year at the Joplin, Missouri Globe. And starting there, and in journalism, we were taught that you don't do that. Reporter about the story. You don't put yourself in the story. And God knows you don't express an opinion.
Right.
That's for the people upstairs who write the editorials. We don't do that. I worry about that a little bit now.
A little bit?
But I know it's still the rule at the good newspapers and the good broadcast people. But, you know, the way, well, I don't want to get into that.
Well, on another, you mentioned after the eulogy that Dr. King delivered, you and your colleagues knew you'd seen history. I'm sure there were several times during your reporting that you knew you had seen history. Was there ever internal pressure that you put on yourself that I gotta get this right? I mean, this was, you know, we didn't have 24/7 cable news networks or things like that. You were the liaison between the event and one of the greatest newspapers in the history of the world. The responsibility for covering history. Did you ever think about that, or were you always on deadline?
No, I never thought of it. It never occurred to me that this was history in the making. Or maybe somewhere in the back of my mind, that good Lord, it just says, you know, this is, well, probably what I thought was, this is a great story. I'm so lucky to be here. Never mind the tear gas and all that. I told Vincent the other day that I had 8 years at the Arkansas Gazette, a year at the Globe, and 14 years at the Times. And they were, I wouldn't take anything for it. It was just great fun. Even the bad times, even times like Pettus Bridge. Because for a reporter, there's nothing to match the adrenaline flow of working on a really good story, and you know at times this is a really good story. The stories that write themselves. You don't have to tune them up.
The incident at Pettus Bridge, I don't know if it's accurate to say it began to change the tide of American public opinion, but eventually the films, the networks, it showed it being broadcast live. I don't know if that was the case, but the films would get flown to New York City, shown on the evening news. Could you tell the tide was turning in popular opinion?
Almost at once. First, because of the TV. These were the real heroes. He gives an accounting of all the things that led up to the passage of this bill and all the old wrongs against African Americans. And then he winds up, his last line is, "And we shall overcome." In the film, it shows black people sitting around their TV sets with tears running down. And I have to tell you, they were running down my. It was a great moment, and it all started there on Bloody Sunday at Selma, Alabama, that quiet little town in South Alabama.
After that death, and the film has made it back to television, and most people are seeing all hell breaking loose. I don't know if you went to the tally-ho that night and unwound or did not. You have a wife in Atlanta who you haven't seen for a bit. Did you call her?
Did I call you?
How do you loved ones know you're okay?
Actually, I know I called her because I was under orders from my boss to call. In fact, that was a rule that the Times had in those days. The national editor made sure every national reporter called home at the end of the day. Did you know that about Clarkson? The national editor. He had been there himself. He knew how important it was that these roving reporters not get very far from home spiritually, that they needed to reestablish that contact every day. Because I can't really explain how it works, but you need to know that you're not just this guy out in Selma or wherever, you know. Your name is Roy Reed, and you're married to Norma Reed, and your kids are Johnny and Cindy, and they matter to you. And Sutton, who had been there, understood the importance of that. And he ordered all of us to call home once a day. So I know I must have called home that night. I never crossed the call sitting in the morning.
If it was a day where there was going to be a march or a speech, you knew what you were going to do. But as you're trying to capture the mood of what is happening in the South, and say there was a day, I don't know, perhaps there weren't any days where there wasn't anything scheduled, what would you wake up and do if there wasn't a specific event?
Well, first of all, there was always something to be done. Be caught up on some story that you've had to postpone. And in the case of the civil rights movement, the stories, if it's just a march where nothing happened, and these were challenging, days where nothing really happened, because you've got the task of trying to make it sound new. We didn't lie. No, we didn't lie about it. We didn't come out and say, folks, nothing new to report here today. But you found some little new angle to lead the story with and develop. And it wasn't hard to find those things, because you always had things in your notebook that you've never got around to writing. But there was it was a 7-day-a-week job, as long as it went on.
You mentioned the Bloody Sunday began to change, making a national discussion. Could you tell in the South that anyone's minds were changing over time? Did attitudes change or shift?
Yes and no. I think the minds of the white supremacists did not change, not a whit. If anything, they dug in. But there were millions of white Southerners who were not these never-enders, not these die-hard, you know. And they became more open. And naturally, they were timid. They didn't want to speak up. A Klan might burn a cross in your yard, or your congregation might rise up against you and run you out of town. So they were naturally reluctant. But gradually, people began to get their nerve and began to speak up. And there would be more and more people, like in Little Rock. There were always a handful of churches, for example, who tried to stand up against Governor Faubus and for integration of schools. And as time went on, there were more, you know, one or two more churches, one or two more pastors. At least one of them lost his church because he was too brave. Our pastor lost 10% of his congregation over a sermon one day, one Sunday. He preached a sermon that made that many people in the congregation angry enough to cancel their membership and walk out and never came back.
It's sometimes hard. I'm in my early 50s, and so I was just a child when this was happening. It's hard for those of us my age and younger to fully understand what was at stake and what was happening at that time. So many of us can take for granted things that have come out of that evolution, but at the time it was high stakes.
Oh yeah. It took a while. It didn't happen overnight.
Right.
It did not. There were a few events like Pettus Bridge where it did happen overnight. That was a national change, and almost immediate. You could see it. People all over the North joined the march and came down. But mainly it was a gradual thing. It was learned papers have been written about it, books have been written. I have to tell you one story from the this is in this book, this story. Some of you old enough to remember can recall this. At the end of the March of Montgomery, the march had gone right up to the Capitol steps. And I took Benson up there, by the way, and showed him where there's a star at the top of the steps before you go in the doors. That marks the spot where Jefferson Davis took the oath of office, President of the Confederacy, and it is sacred ground in Alabama to this day. George Wallace, Governor George Wallace, was standing behind the drapes watching this horde of people, like 25,000 of them, march up the Dexter Avenue. And luckily for the times, we had a reporter named Ben Franklin who had got on George's side years before, and he allowed Ben to be up there with him in Georgia. And Ben got this terrific sidebar about, George Wallace watching history being made out there on his capital. So it all ended there, with Martin King giving one more terrific speech. And then everybody scattered, headed home, bus stations, trains, airplanes. And all of us reporters and television people and the two or three radio people, but there were never more than just two or three radio people. I don't know why. I guess it was so much a television story. Anyway, all of us were gathered at the Elite Cafe, E-L-I-T-E, Elite Cafe. Called us down about his liquor laws, one of the handful of places where you could have a martini. And it was served in a coffee cup. And we were all there, and just not really, I don't think any of us had finished our dinner when John Doerr was called to the telephone. John Doerr was the Justice Department guy on the scene. He was sent down there to oversee the whole march and make sure everything. And he was the federal presence, and a hero of mine, by the way, and a great human being. He hung up the phone and went from table to table and told all of us reporters what the telephone call was about. Mrs. Viola Liuzzo, a white mother of six from Detroit, who had joined Rome to come down to help out in the march, had been shot to death on the highway between Selma and Montgomery. A car full of Ku Klux Klansmen had pulled alongside her, and one of them rolled the window down and leaned out and shot her dead. And quick footnote, unknown to the guy who did the shooting and the other two of the others, there was an FBI informer in the car pretending to be a Klansman. And so they were brought to justice, not exactly, but that night, when the word spread that she had been killed, we all had to get up and go back to work. And when I took Vincent down there, I made sure to stop at the place on the side of the road where she was shot to death. Actually, not where she was shot. She was shot at the bottom of a slope in the highway, and her car drifted out of control another 300 or 400 yards up the road and went off the road and into a fence and stopped. She had a young black man with her. She had been ferrying people back and forth, Selma to Montgomery to catch planes, that kind of thing. She was making her last trip of the day. And this happened. The young black fellow was about 18, 19 years old. Terrified, as you might expect, managed to get out of the car and run off across a pasture and into some brush, because they were after him. They wanted to kill him too. And he lived to tell the story. So we all had to, that was the way we ended our day. Instead of on a triumphal note, one great story ended, and said it ended like that. And I showed Vincent the marker on the highway that now there's a proper plaque with telling the whole story about, about 100 words as you get on the plaque. An honest accounting of who she was and what happened there that day here in South Alabama. You know, it's a public place, and tourists are invited to stop and see where this little bit of history was made. And that told me, and I told Vincent, that this, I would not have believed 50 years ago this would be possible in Alabama, even 50 years hence, but it's changed that much. And that's the way we, Vincent and I, found Selma. That whole, it's an incredible trip. I'm so glad we had been telling Tom about it.
But we're passing, but I want to ask about one other story that you told me when I was in your journalism classics class. 31 years ago? And I think your memory's better than mine. You remember the E-Light, the tally-ho, and all of this. I don't want to give away too many details to spoil the story. I actually just personally want to hear the story again, but I believe there was a time when you were on this beat when the editors of the New York Times didn't believe a story that you had witnessed. Without giving away too much, someone who was believed to have been fatally injured. Is this ringing a bell? And you...
Yo, yes, okay, fine. Y'all remember James Meredith?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Who integrated the OMS way back in 62 or 3, I guess. And in 1966, I think it was June of 66, James Meredith, who had been living in New York City, came back home and announced that he was going to march the whole length of his home state of Mississippi and just prove that he could do it. Well, they proved him wrong first day out. He started out from Memphis, and I and the whole, you know, a whole bunch of other reporters and photographers were there. And we followed him down the highway. And don't know if you know this, but the state line between Tennessee and Mississippi is just really in the suburbs of Memphis, just a few miles out there. And then you're in Mississippi. And he made it, I think he made it all of 12 miles into the state of Mississippi before somebody shot him, proving that no, you can't do this, Jay. Not yet. Didn't hurt him very bad, but some poor young reporter, I felt so sorry for the kid. He was a new kid on the United Press International. Is Judy Carey here?
Yeah.
You remember when the United Press was UPI. Well, I hate to tell you, but, and I know Bob Carey would have been as embarrassed as I was over this, but in those days, the wire services had their offices in the newsrooms of the major newspaper, in the case of Memphis, Memphis Commercial Appeal. And both the Associated Press and United Press had their offices in the newsroom. And this young reporter for UPI was walking past one of the Commercial Appeal's desk and overheard they shot Meredith, and he understood, he misheard, he thought they killed Meredith. He ran to his wireless apparatus and typed out a bullet, all voice, Meredith shot dead. Oh, that poor guy, can you imagine? But, you know, you don't assume anything, but he thought he heard what he didn't hear. Well, it was about an hour before I find my way to a telephone. Shall I tell the whole story?
It's a great story.
Well, it's embarrassing, but I was not there. I was on a car, taking it easy, sort of walking every step of the way. And I would drive behind the march for a while, and then I'd go ahead and wait for it to catch up, and then fall back. It was a hot, miserable day, and I had three other media people with me, a photographer, maybe a couple of other reporters, and I'd like to say it was not my decision, but we stopped at a little country store and got some cold drinks. And while we were in that store, one of our group looked up and said, why are those people running? They were running on down the road. Well, they were running to the scene where James Meredith had been shot. So we went hurrying down there in my car, and I got us all there in time to establish that James Meredith was not killed. In fact, he wasn't even seriously injured. He had a back full of birdshot. It took the hospital in Memphis the better part of a day, I think, to pick them all out one by one. But I heard him on the ground trying to say something. I don't think he was talking to me, but he's talking to somebody. So I knew he was alive. So when I finally reached the telephone, and you had to find a payphone somewhere, you know, on the side of the road, and called in, I got Claude sitting, the national editor, on the phone. And he didn't ask me where I was or anything. He said, "Is he alive or dead?" And I said, "He's alive." He said, "Are you sure?" "Yes, I heard him talking." "Hold on." He ran to across the room. The Times had a radio station in those days, had it, and they were on the verge of airing the false news.
Because they'd gotten the wire copy.
They'd got the wire copy that he was dead. And Claude was running over to the WQXR desk to say, "He's alive, he's alive." So our radio station was the only broadcast station in New York who got it right. And for that, I won a publisher's prize. Never mind that, you know, I was not really, and my buddies, who, you know, my friends at Loud, Jack Nelson and Gene Roberts and a bunch of them, decided to give me a special present when I at a going away party when I left Atlanta to move to Washington. And the present they gave me was somebody had got a hold of a Coca-Cola bottle.
Right.
And had it mounted in a plastic with the engraving. Claude had been looking at the pictures coming in on the wire photo machine, and none of them had me in the picture. All said somebody, "Where's Roy Reed?" So this thing had it engraved at the bottom, "Where's Roy Reed?" Just reminded me of my dad.
Well, Roy, thank you so much for spending time.
I'm going to have three copies of the paper. Thank you.
I'm Victoria Aubrey. Very nice to meet you.